Good advice. Cybersecurity is something I think is important to everyone, and you know, Greg's advice is very, very good. In order to stay more secure, stay as close as you can to the latest kernel version. Now we want to talk about a topic that is on the top of everyone's mind. You know, China is referred to as the AI lab of the world. Artificial intelligence is a huge movement here in China, and we are lucky today to have two folks to talk to us about the latest in artificial intelligence. Please welcome from Huawei, Peijing Ho, and from China Mobile, Dr. Feng Jilan.
Hi, Jim.
Hello.
Hi, Jim.
Welcome. Thank you. Yeah. Go ahead and have a seat. So we're talking artificial intelligence, we're talking open source. I thought maybe it would be helpful for each of you to just quickly introduce yourselves and tell the audience a little bit about how you're using AI and ML in your companies, and just get us started.
Okay, so good morning to everyone here. I'm Jun Lang. I currently work for China Mobile as the chief scientist to focus on AI and next generation network R&D.
My name is Peixing, and I'm from Huawei. I have been working in the open source for quite a long time, and recently I joined the AI effort in the company, and I got some background in the neural networks and pattern recognition. So I think the new boom of AI brings a lot of opportunities for both companies and developers.
Yeah. So it seems like with every big new technology movement, whether it's blockchain or big data or cloud computing, open source is now really the fundamental infrastructure for almost everything that is being implemented, whether it's at China Mobile or a big company like Huawei to create products and services. I'd love to hear about what open source projects you're looking at maybe using in your organization as it relates to AI.
Okay, maybe starting from me. In AI, I think because the AI, there are so many AI projects, open source projects, and a lot of them are very good. So in Huawei, we basically use a lot of open source AI open source projects in different layers. So for example, just to take example of the training framework, we use MXNet, we use TensorFlow, and even Caffe2 in different labs, different product lines. And more importantly, we also use some other big data projects to process and to manipulate data, because this generation of artificial intelligence is really data driven. Mm-hmm. And so a lot of projects we have been using. Some of projects we participated very, actively. We contributed code back, and in a lot of areas. Jim, I think just now you mentioned about the user scenario and the user application in Huawei. I think I want to add a little bit, more about that, because in Huawei, AI is not only a tool to improve our product and the solutions. It has also been heavily used in our internal procedure to increase our internal efficiency. As you know, Huawei is a very big ICT solution provider. Take one example for logistics and the shipping, because every time when we do a lot of solution, when we ship solutions, for example, base station to China Mobile, that system is a very complicated one. It has a lot of parts and mechanics, packages, and actually the shipping itself is very challenging, because the shipping need to be arrived on site in a very good sequence and in very good timing. And previously that was done by human beings, experts, but recently we incorporated artificial intelligence, which basically provide much better time to market and much better efficiency to our customer. So this is just one single simple example for how AI has been used in Huawei to improve our efficiency.
Interesting. Now, you deal with the biggest essentially mobile network in the world, right? So 850 million users, the complexity, the volume, the speed at which you need to work is just amazing. Tell us about how at China Mobile you're using the different technologies, what you're seeing in terms of this area.
Okay. So we are more kind of demand driven versus technology driven. So there's just so many great AI related softwares, supporting systems. We can't track all of them. It's hard to follow out. So we're trying to kind of consolidate based on our business needs. So there are four things that we try to do. First is we're trying to put together a general platform which can support corporate-wide applications, AI-related applications. So for that, so we do support most open source deep learning framework, reinforcement learning framework, and GAN, the generative learning framework. So we'll follow the main trend. For now, for the major ones, we do heavily use TensorFlow. We use for speech, we use Kali. For NLP, natural language processing, we mainly use TensorFlow. We use a lot of Theano too. The kind of the old one, the research style, but we are quite familiar, so easy to change and improve. And for business, we use this platform to support customer care. I think customer care is truly a field AI has, for generations, generation AI has really heavy influence on. We have China Mobile now, I think it put together our mobile customers and broadband customers. We have, I think, over a billion number of customers, so customer care is important for us. The second one is the marketing. So how we apply AI to truly improve our marketing sales efficiency. And third one is the biggest one, is the network. It's the network intelligence. There are tons of problems that we're facing. We hope AI can help. For that, we use quite a lot of smaller one open source softwares to support. So it's truly based on whatever we need, we grab the software, and then for those we heavily use, we have to learn and capable to really change and improve. And for the smaller ones, we contribute back to the open source community.
Got it. Yeah, you know, I get this question all the time from different organizations and people saying, you know, I've got data, I need to train a bunch of models, I need to put them into a production pipeline and deploy them in my enterprise for customer care, natural language recognition, whatever it is. But the number one question I always get is, you know, there's PyTorch and TensorFlow and MXNet and all these different components, and I'm not sure how to set up the pipeline correctly. You know, what advice, you know, Paige, I'll start with you, what advice would you give people as they're looking across sort of a complex landscape of different software, different open source projects in terms of like getting started or picking the right one? Like, it seems confusing.
Yeah, it is. The practice we have is some of these, for example, the training framework you just mentioned, you know, are originated from their kind of specific user scenario application. So, for example, like image processing, a lot of people when you you have a lot of you know images, you try to do a lot of you know AI work. When you start it, you probably when you look at the paper probably will point you to the framework. You know, might have been implemented the algorithm described in the paper. So I think for a developer, for the data scientist, it's very easy for them to start to go into one framework then start to work from the beginning to the end. And the problem is later they find out when I want to try to switch to another framework, I got some difficulty. So one suggestion I have is currently there are some high-level API. So for example, like Gluon, you know, the high level API.
Gluon.
Yes, yes. Which can help, you know, to specify your workload, your training workload, and then define, okay, which training framework you will try to use. So maybe this is one suggestion, you know, try to use some high level API, you know, open source projects. But I think another problem, you know, especially for me, is how to pre-process or how to prepare the data. I find that is very challenging, especially when people try to put them into different industry verticals. Actually, the biggest problem they face is, I don't know how to pre-process my existing data to feed them into the TensorFlow, feed them into the MXNet. So actually, the preparation stage is very important. And I think there are more and more projects doing that. So I suggest the people, the developer, to keep close eyes in that area. Because that area, I think, will probably have the next boom in the AI open source, you know, projects. Because for the training framework, we have a lot of them already. But I think for the data part, I think we are just the beginning. We have a lot of existing big data. But for AI, we need more advanced data processing open source projects. And I think the next stage, we will see more and more in that area.
So more work to do on the data processing side, more work on the pipeline side.
Yes.
It sounds like China Mobile is experiencing this as, you know, just pragmatically, you're picking a framework depending on what you need to get done, and you got a lot of them. I mean, is this what you experience, and how would you like to see that change? What would make your life easier if there was, you know, more consolidation in the open source frameworks, if there was more general purpose frameworks? What would you like to see?
Okay, I guess probably everyone has their own philosophy of picking and learning. Every company has its own style. Personally, I often talk to colleagues and, you know, our company coworkers saying you have to, there are a couple of things that we want to mention. One is it has to be useful. I'm thinking this world kind of, for me, is every morning you wake up and then you feel like pretty scary. There are so many people who are super smart. Every day you check the papers, their new inventions, their new ideas, and everything's changing in the world and becoming younger and younger. And now we have machines even more smart, way more smarter than so we are. So we're, you know, facing this quite complicated world. What are we going to do? So there are a couple of things I really suggest to people we work together. One is really focus. I don't think anyone can master the whole stack of technology. No one can in our life of time. It's impossible. Second, I really want to say, once you pick whatever you want to focus on, do we always say AI as one word? Actually means lots of things.
Right.
So I'm thinking if you work on natural language processing, if you work on dialogue generation, if you work on image, face, and object recognition, more specific, just concentrate on that problem and then go deeper. So once you pick whatever you want to focus on, and there are lots of softwares people use, I mean, you can track that field. Second one I really want to say is to go back to the basic. Because there are tons of great open source software you can grab, and you can marry that software with your data. And you can, within probably a couple hours a day, you can create a certain capabilities, and you can claim you're capable of doing something. Actually, you don't really understand what's the basics. So when you apply this into real business, there will be problems. That won't be that easy. If you are incapable of really improve it, understand what's behind the scene, I think you put yourself into a certain risk. So we're thinking is to focus and truly go back to the basic and make it useful. Once you are in there, I guess you can definitely enjoy the beauty of the macro side of the programming, coding, and where the intelligence come from. So in terms of overall, I also, another dimension is pick open source software which you feel like you have a strong community who can support. Because the tons of problems that you're trying to solve on your own, maybe that takes days and months.
Right.
But if you have a community, you can search online, you can ask, friends in your company, you can ask people around you, find a solution much faster. So pretty much that's...
Yeah. No, I mean, that's great advice. And, you know, it seems like we're early on in terms of the maturity of a lot of this technology, and there's all these different little communities out there, some clearly larger, you know, MXNet, TensorFlow, some of these communities, but still a lot of different things. You know, Peijing, AT&T, you know, they open sourced a bunch of code called Acumos.
Yes.
And the goal for them was not necessarily, you know, pick one framework versus another, but allow a production pipeline that would be able to better share models,
yes,
share data sets, so that, you know, they could then reuse those just inside AT&T. So this was a problem that they had in their organization. I'm sure you have the same problem at China Mobile. Mm-hmm. And the idea here would be, you know, to create this marketplace to be able to facilitate this. You know, you've seen this. Give me your thoughts on projects like that, what you're seeing in the market. I see commercial products. Amazon has SageMaker,
yes,
which is a very similar tool to the Acumos open source project. Give me your thoughts on these kind of projects.
Yeah, I think Acumos to myself is a very good one. You know, it probably not as stylish as TensorFlow, but it's a very fundamental one, because it basically created this kind of pipeline to allow different open source, AI open source component to be integrated. Because just now I talk about the vertical industry, when they try to apply the AI in their, you know, scenarios, I think if they know Acumos, this kind of project, I think it's more easier for them to bring in the AI experience, you know, from the open source world. I think the marketplace is also very vital in the whole ecosystem, because that's a place, you know, where data scientists, the data engineer, and the developer, application developer, can exchange. And I also think in the future, if we can, you know, incorporate technology like blockchain, which basically will make the data exchange, model exchange, more economic driven, and probably, you know, will bring the ecosystem richer and the more, you know, to a better. So I think a project like Acumos is definitely a very good starting point. But of course, there are still a lot of things need to be done in that pipeline. You know, more stages need to be added in, and more components need to be integrated in.
Dr. Feng, do you think that we're gonna see a world where you have, you know, aside from just working in open source on the technology infrastructure, more actual sharing of models and of data sets amongst, let's say, affinity communities like networking companies, you know, big global operators, or supply chain management companies? Do you think that that's something that's just, hey, that's our secret, that gives us competitive advantage? Like, where do you see the world going in terms of sharing the data and these models amongst different organizations?
So I had worked at AT&T for over 12 years.
Okay, so you're using both sides of the...
I'm quite happy for AT&T. They changed the culture very quickly, and to focus on software, focus on AI. AT&T has over 60 years experience on speech, image, video processing. So definitely they're very good on AI. So I learned Acumos a couple months ago. Good to meet friends out there. But I probably have a different ideas to see. So I'm thinking Acumos is trying to solve a problem is the kind of problem I think we chatted yesterday is the AI efficiency.
Mm.
So in real business, at least as of today, which quite different from a couple years back, we're trying to find use cases, we're trying to find business opportunities to apply AI. Now it's the other one around. They have so many. There's so many opportunities you can apply AI. You can make a difference in real business. Then the problem comes back is saying each of them costs a lot to make it work. You have to work with business to collect the data, collect the right data. That's a long cycle. You have the matter iterations to really to get it right. And then you have the AI developers to closely work with the business. You have to be humble. The technology needs to be humble. The people behind AI needs to be humble to understand what's truly their bottleneck problems. Otherwise, you may create something creepy or disappointing. You have to truly respect what their truly problem is, and then you convert this whole business problem into an AI problem that you can solve. For AI, you have to take data, you have to know what your X or your Y, what's your input or your output, and then you have to test in the business. Often the case is when you apply, it works in a way, but not as much as they expected, and then you need when they're trusted to have more iterations to let it grow. So the kind of efficiency, I think, is truly the problem now, I think, is somehow hindering AI to creating a bigger value. So I'm thinking Acumus is trying to, you know, can we have a model marketplace?
Yeah.
So we can share on a model level. At least for now, as of today, I think it's very hard. At least for telecom communication industry, we do have so many problems, and each problem is quite individually, uniquely defined. Mm. So I think we are lack that level of abstraction. So once you create a model for those each very specific problems, when you grab that model, apply in different scenario, applying slightly different problems, oftentimes they won't work.
Hmm.
And then you need to adaptation, to do transfer learning, although there are lots of research papers on transfer learning, but it's not, I think, it commercially proved successful yet. Although lots of trying, we try a lot of those technologies too. Just to give you an example, since China is quite big, you have 31 provinces. Once we create the same thing, we create a model for province A, then we transfer that model from province B, after the time it won't work automatically.
Mm.
So I really hope it works. I think one day it will work. But I'm thinking, I talked to Mazen, who is leading the Acumus
and AT&T. Mazen Gilbert. Yeah,
yeah, we both kind of came from speech recognition background. So I'm thinking if truly is the case that we can stay on a model level for certain problems like speech recognition, image, and probably certain natural language problem, the problem has to be defined very simple. So you're facing something generic. So once the problem is simple, probably that model is general.
Right.
In that field, in that problem. For lots of business problems that we are facing, I really hold my doubt. I hope it works.
I mean, it's difficult, but I like this concept of AI efficiency, right? If you're, you know, running a business unit, trying to continually move towards optimal AI efficiency, picking those abstractions, trying to generalize, the frameworks and models and so on, is what find that. Seems like directionally where people want to. You point out that it's super hard. It's going to take a while.
My opinion is I totally agree with Dr. Fan's comments. But another thing I want to add is overall, I think AI should be more and more open because we have this kind of black boxing problem, you know, which impacted the industry. And actually, a lot of people started concerned about the AI. But only if we can make the AI, for example, model more open, to be more shareable, I think this will decrease the concern and eventually put the AI into a wider use. So, I mean, this is just a simple comment, so but I think overall...
More trust, more efficiency by opening it up. Yeah,
and also more secure.
Yeah.
So this, I have been thinking this for a while, saying for every AI problem which proved very successful now as face recognition, as object recognition, and the speech. There's one thing common is they have that community has a very big, huge data set behind it. So which means all the researchers and technologists and developers can take the same data set and tune their technology, improving on the same thing. And the testing has been consolidated, has all you one common way to test the technology, has one training data to tune on. So I was thinking is, how about, you know, for example, for each industry, for telecom, as example, maybe a suggestion for Linux Foundation, instead of you know, beyond what we are sharing today, the open source, we share on a coding level, can we do on a data level? I guess because telecom industry is still with lots of customers, we have the privacy concerns, we have security and lots of concerns, but I don't think that should be just a stop for us to share the data. There'll be one way or another. Yeah. We can create a data to a decent size, which can really support lots of researchers, lots of smart people to work on, so we can collectively push the technology forward without this common data set. So each one talks a different story, actually. Yes. So I
swear we did not rehearse this question, but you know, we have been thinking about this at the Linux Foundation for a long time. And so last year, Peijing, I think you're aware of it, you're on our board, we created an open data license. Mm-hmm. So one of because I agree, I think the data sharing is critical for the advancement of this field. And when you look back historically, one of the things that made open source so efficient was the open source licenses.
Yes.
You know, the Apache license, the GPL license, made the flow of data, the intellectual property framework of sharing, very easy and repeatable, right? Because these were all similar. So we actually created an open data license, a copyleft style license, sort of with a share back requirement. If you add or modify data, you share data back. And then a permissive license, which is, you know, everyone can share it and there's an attribution to it. But I totally agree. My question is, we have, a legal construct to share that data. The question is industry going to hoard data or share it? Where are we going to see, you know, are we going to see data consolidation and centralization and exploitation and monetization, or are we going to see, you know, more sharing, or maybe a combo of both? Final thoughts on this particular topic, because I think you're right, it's a hugely important thing.
Yeah. There are lots of technologies that you can apply on clean the data to protect, to respect our customers' privacy. But I'm thinking is, if we collectively work, we'll find a way to share the data. Mm. Once that data is available, we all can work on the same problem, the technology will go forward. For example, I'm thinking is each speech, image, and natural language processing, they grab the general framework, AI framework, to make it work for them. And when they solve the concrete problem, they find the new inventions. You have to create a different kinds of nets. You have to find different ways to optimize your neural network. New contributor back, and then find, oh, this is not only work for image, this is work for other problems,
yeah,
too. So I'm thinking is, as our industry, as I come from telecom, so I don't think we are there yet. So I'm thinking if we have that abstraction layer of, you have to abstract our problems, since our problems are so many.
Yeah.
For a network, you have different phases. You have planning and design, you have the operation, you have the optimization, now you have the 5G, you have tons of problems on a daily basis. So our business is quite complicated. So, I don't know, there are lots of key problems we need to solve. We have to solve, otherwise we cannot. It will become a problem for other industries to rely on
right. This
network. So I truly hope we have that data set. I heavily search a lot, and I guess probably back to several years ago, there was one data set opened by Orange. There's a couple of years back, I forgot which company, but it's from European company too. So I'm hoping it's not like every paper you read, lots of papers on the apply AI on network, on telecom industry, but none of the data is truly available. We just don't have that common thing.
Yeah.
Once we have that common thing, I'm thinking is not only solve our problem, when we solve our, because our problems are unique, when you try to working on this, you will find new inventions and then you can contribute back to AI versus it's just one way we use them, but we don't contribute much back to the core.
Yeah. Well, unfortunately, we're out of time here, but you've both left us with a lot of challenges here. So help to consolidate and create useful general purpose ML and modeling tools, find the right abstractions, increase the frameworks that allow for the pipeline to be more efficient, increase the AI efficiency, do better data sharing, find the data abstraction layers so that we can have more efficient data sharing. We got so much work to do here. Hopefully all of you can join in the Linux Foundation Deep Learning community as just one of the many communities in this area to go solve some of these problems. And I really appreciate both of you spending time today with all of us to talk about this. So thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.